So now, having seen the sequential memory consistency model, what we can do is go back to our original example and ask the question, what are all the possible outcomes for this particular set of memory accesses performed on P1 and P2? Now, what possible values can D and C get? Well, obviously, you can get the first choice, no problem with that. You can get the second choice, you can get the third choice, and as we illustrated earlier, all of these are just interleaving of these memory accesses on P1 and P2. But the fourth one is not possible with sequential consistency because there's no interleaving of these memory accesses and these memory accesses that will result in this particular outcome. That's comforting. That's exactly what we thought would be a useful thing to have in a memory consistency model that gives only intuitive results and make sure that non-intuitive results don't happen. Memory consistency model is what the application programmer needs to be aware of to develop his code and know that it will execute correctly on the shared memory machine. As operating system designers, however, we need to help make sure that his code runs quickly. To do that, we need to understand how to implement the model efficiently and also the relationship between hardware and software that makes it possible to achieve this goal. So now we understand that memory consistency model is what is the model that is presented to the programmer. That's what memory consistency model is. On the other hand, cache coherence is how is the system implementing the model in the presence of private caches. So this is a handshake, a partnership between hardware and software, between the application programmer and the system, in order to make sure that the consistency model is actually implemented correctly by the cache coherence mechanism that is ingrained in the system. And the system implementation of cache coherence is itself a hardware-software trade-off. Now, for instance, one possibility is that the hardware is only giving shared address space. It's not giving you any way of making sure that the caches are coherent, but it is giving you the shared address space. And it is letting the software, the system software, ensure that this contract is somehow satisfied in the working of the cache coherence maintained in software by the system. That's one possibility. And that is what is called a non-cache coherent shared address space multiprocessor, meaning that there is shared address space that's available for all the processors. There is private caches for holding data that you bring from memory, but if you modify data, it is a problem of the system software to make sure that the caches remain coherent. So it's non-cache coherent. That is called NCC, shared memory multiprocessor. The other possibility, of course, is that the hardware does everything. It provides the shared address space, but it also maintains cache coherence in hardware. And that's what is called a cache coherent multiprocessor, or a CC multiprocessor.